Dahil sa'yo,
nais kong
Now, you didn't tell me your NPA, or how do you identify yourself, NDF, NPA?
No, I'm not NPA. The only gun I carried was a short 22 pistol.
I have the comfort of the kind of family I was born to, but I had difficulties with my first grade. My parents forgot that they did not teach me the alphabet before being brought to school, no? So I had difficulties with grade one. And I became literate only in grade three when one of our girl servants taught me how to read the vernacular magazine. So, Badawag, you know? And then, of course, at grade four, I started to top my class. And my family would start to imagine I could be a lawyer and could be president. So every family has that kind of dream, no?
My parents were very liberal. And so they were barrio school teachers. These were small barrios owned by landlords. And people were always in debt. And you know how debts are. They just pile up and pile up because they're so usurious, no? They borrow seeds for planting. Let's say one can. That's the petrol can that they use. In the bios, they measure the rice by the petrol can, which is probably 10 gallons or so. They have to pay that back in the harvest, during the harvest time. And it's almost always four times.
No, but I also got my anti-feudal education when I was a child. You see, my classmates would include children of our tenants. and both sides would tell me, oh, your great grandfather became rich because he grabbed the land of our grandfather or great grandfather. And when I got home, I would repeat the stories told me. I told my parents, you know what ka means? Kando. Bu means bookless, greedy. Gaw, aga-agaw, means grabber. Oh, that really. So, as a child, I was irreverent, no?
So they came with complaints to my father. That's why, he had a lot of social conscience, and he often dealt with the landlord. Uh-huh. And I was always with him when he was dealing with the landlord. So I learned how the peasants lived, how hard put they were. They worked so hard while the landlord stayed in the town, and his inquilino, his the person in charge would be the one looking after his land. So I thought that was so unjust.
I first got my patriotic and anti-colonial education from my parents in a random way. They talk a lot about my grandfather being supportive of the Philippine Revolution and getting arrested together with his children by the U.S. colonial authorities. You know, my great-grandfather and his three male children were all arrested on fake charges of murder because the American troops were being ambushed at the outskirts of the town, no? That's a good ambush area, no?
Joma was in Ateneo at first. well, first 2 years, mm-hmm. until he was kicked out.
I said what?
He was kicked out. He fought with one of his classmates, and they got caught. Although they had a, before they fought, they had a pact that no one would squeal. But when the prefect of discipline started investigating them, the other one broke down and said they were fighting, no? Because some, I think the prefect or whoever saw them in the fields fight, boxing or fighting. And he maintained the story that they were just playing. So that was another score against him.
Did they both get in trouble or just him?
Just him, because the other one told the truth.
And while I was at the Ateneo, I would be told Bonifacio was only a thug in Tondo. I would be shocked. I was shocked when I was told that, no? And then Recto, who was admired by my father, the Jesuits should describe as a crazy communist. So I thought there must be something good about being communist. So I looked for books, but I couldn't find. I could only find anti-communist books. But then in my third year high school, when I had already transferred to Letran, I read an anti-communist book written by someone who was taking his PhD at Fordham University, another Jesuit school, no? In the U.S. And I think the guy, while being anti-communist and upholding Christian philosophy, it was something about Christian philosophy against Marxist philosophy, but the author made the mistake of quoting extensively from Marx and Engels, and I thought Marx and Engels made more sense.
Ironically, it was the USIS where I got my social conscience, at the USIS, United States Information Service, because they had libraries in the major cities. So I had my high school, I was 11 when I was in high school, and so I started visiting the library and got hold of, you know, the Grapes of Wrath, or all these American social novels. My aunt, who was gay, had a partner, and she was teaching literature. So they had a collection of a lot of literature books. So I read the Decameron Nights, I think I was 12. So, and then Don Quixote. So I suppose those were my formative years, and it influenced my thinking and my sensitivity for the needs of the oppressed, no? The good earth impressed me. although I did not really grasp the whole, you know, the whole stories or the themes, no? I just had a sense of identifying the events there with what I saw in the social milieu.
One of the good points about my father was that he admired Claro Mayor Recto. Why? Like Jose Rizal, he was a maxima cum laude. You know, that's supposed to be even higher than summa. If you are maxima cum laude, you are a man in a half century. Perfect, almost perfect score. And then she said, you follow the pattern of Recto. What amounted to his high school, he became a journalist. And then he studied law. So you should take journalism first, and then you go to law. And then you go to Harvard. You come back. after getting your Harvard postgrad degree, you come back, give free legal services, and you can replace Crisologo. He was then the Floro Crisologo was then the congressman. So, you know.
How do you feel about that? Did you want to be the congressman?
Up to 1957, I suppose I had that plan, becoming a journalist and then a lawyer. When I entered the University of the Philippines, there was a intense struggle between what I would call the religious sectarians and the liberals. You see, the ideology of the university is officially liberal, and it's supposed to be, its academic freedom is supposed to be protected by the principle of the separation of church and state. So, you might say that the university was a creation of the Filipino revolutionaries who wanted a liberal institution, and at the same time, the Americans wanted that sort of university, because the Americans also presented themselves as Jeffersonian liberals, whereas the Filipino revolutionaries thought of themselves as liberals in the French, in the tradition of the French Revolution. No? So there is a congruence there. It was a liberal institution. So when I entered, I was sympathetic to the liberals against the religious sectarians. The anti-subversion law which threatened the death penalty for officers of the Communist Party, and 6 months imprisonment if the communists would turn, it would be a mere member and turn himself over, surrender himself. It served more to challenge us to fight for democratic rights than to be afraid. My wife was a library science student. I got to know the Marxist books hidden in the basement of the university library. They were hidden there by the librarians because the military wanted those books to be destroyed.
By the time I was first year in the university, I got hold of the Communist Manifesto and read it. And that's how I I started.
Did you meet Julie as part of these activities?
We were classmates in literature. And then when we started study groups, then she was joining. And then when we were preparing placards, streamers for demonstrations, she could not avoid being involved. Yeah. So by reading Marxist books and at the same time, reading the Marxist books, knowing about how a new democratic revolution can be carried out under the leadership of the working class in the era of imperialism and proletarian revolution. So I thought that the students and the faculty members should be aroused, organized, and mobilized towards the line of having the new democratic revolution. They had to be cryptic because there was the anti-subversion law. The death penalty was a threat to anyone who was a Marxist.
You know, I never had any other boyfriend before him, for Joma. So, well, so when we started to be serious with each other, I wrote my parents that I was serious with someone. Even as we were influenced by Sartre and Simone de Beauvoir, no? And I thought that we could be very free of conventions. But I had to think of my parents. What would they think? I just shacked up with somebody without any ceremony or paper. So I was thinking of them, no? Although somehow in my own, you know, the values influenced by Sartre and Simone de Beauvoir, I was ashamed of myself for wishing to have something in paper.
What did Joma think?
I don't know what he thought. So we went to the city hall and had ourselves secretly married by the justice of the peace.
And
then we started to live together.
Then my mother insisted that we are married in church, no? So we got married in church, January 3, 1960.